Are we missing anybody? Yeah, we've got open seats up here. We should have scrapped those back seats, but that's all right. Yeah. Well, apart from Kevin's injury, have most of you had a fun day today?
Yes.
Yeah? Things go all right? You're enjoying this, Max? I'm glad. All right. Good. Well, hey, I had a couple of you approach me and say, hey, so Dominic's a musician. Like, why doesn't he sing us a song? Would you guys like to hear a song? I do want you to know that he didn't, like, come to me and say, hey, is it all right if I... No, that's not what's going on. I had to ask him and say, hey, would you play us a song? And so he's willing to do that to start us off tonight. And so we're going to kick it off with that, and then we're going to shift into a time of worship. The way the order of the service is going to go tonight, we're going to do a couple songs of worship up front, and then the kids are going to be dismissed after that and go to their class and do their thing. And then Dominic's going to give us a message, and then we're going to have an extended time of worship and prayer together this evening. So it's going to be great. So I hope you're energized and you're ready to go. Got this all squared away for me. Step on that. Just that lip button, that should light you up. There you go. Awesome. So here's Dominic. Warm welcome. Come on.
All right. Here we go. I'm going to give you, this is going to be a little crowd participation song, okay? Brett, I'm going to extend this. You're going to have to put it back. Sorry, bro. Prophet Isaiah says a lot of things about God, but one of the things he says about him is that the Lord is a warrior. That he's like a man of war who shouts out with a triumphant cry of victory over his enemies. The reason that's so encouraging to us is because there are so many battles in life that are impossible for us to conquer, right? There's too many mountains too big to climb, giants too big to defeat. I love that we have a God who fights for us. Amen? So there's this part of the chorus where it says that. It says, triumph cries out a shout of victory. So what I'm going to ask you to do is when I sing that lyric, a shout of victory, I'm going to ask y'all to just make some crazy noise in this place. Here's the deal. The walls of Jericho, right? They needed to be broken down. And God gives this crazy command to the priests. He's like, hey, march around 7 times with the armies and blow the trumpets every day. And so they're blowing the trumpets. And I don't know what happens, if it's in the spiritual realm or something in the mortar, it's starting to like crack, I don't know. But on the 7th day, he says, walk around the walls, blow the trumpets. And then when you hear this specific note that's being played by the trumpets, raise a loud shout. And as you shout, the walls are going to come tumbling down. So I'm just saying, maybe we don't want these walls to come down, but in our own lives, like, there are things that just seem impossible. Maybe when we lift up a shout, maybe, who knows, some walls will come tumbling down in our own lives. Besides, it's just biblical. The Bible says to shout unto God with the voice of triumph. It's not something we have a culture of doing in a lot of our churches and stuff, but when I sing that lyric, triumph cries out, a shout of victory, I just want y'all to make some noise. You can say a word, you can say a phrase, you can say something praise, you can say just a sound, whatever, but here's the deal, you got to participate. If we don't all participate, then it's not going to be cool. I'm going to go back to the beginning of the song, I'm just going to keep starting until we get it right, all right? All right, this song's called Warrior. When I say a shout of victory, you make some noise. Overflowing with the good theme, I recite my composition concerning the king. My tongue is like the pen of a ready writer. Selah. Stopped at your presence, dry praise. 1,000 years was still the same. was like a man with all his lights. Push out of the darkness from night, just try to cry. I feel like y'all need to stand up. Come on. But the Lord is my shelter from my enemies. I will not fear what they can do to me. In the struggle, I find strength for the fight. We'll raise the banner high until we break the night. Mount up with spiritual armor. But the weapons of this warfare are far from carnal, but mighty in God. We're tearing down strongholds. Yeah, yeah. The Lord. Yes, the Lord is the warrior that fights. We got all this empty and he strikes and he's trying to cry. Here comes a shout of victory.
name is beautiful, your name is wonderful, your name is powerful. You are all the Almighty, and we worship you. Thank you for this evening, Lord. We pray that you continue to just draw us to you in worship. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys can all have a seat, and the kids can head on out to their classes right now. And I believe there's going to be a light on somewhere back that way. Maybe so that you can find where you need to go. There's some teachers back there.
Such a joy to be with you guys today. Thank you for letting me be here. I'm going to read a passage from Ephesians 5. If you want to turn there, it'll also be up on the screens. And we'll pray. We'll get into it. Ephesians 5, starting in verse 15. I'm going to read verses 15 through 18 just for some context, but verse 19 is what I want us to focus on. So then, Paul says, be careful how you walk, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of your time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine in which there is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your hearts to the Lord. Let's pray one more time. Lord, as we just participated in, what a joy it is to worship together in song. What a gift music is to every single one of us. Thank you for it. And we ask that tonight, as we talk a bit about it, that you would illuminate things for us and that you would help us to respond accordingly. We ask it in your powerful name. So because I did music for a lot of years full time, and I knew the struggle of it, just with my family, you know, being gone all the time, financially, it's a really hard thing to make a living at, you can imagine my disdain when my 16-year-old a year ago came to me and said, escape it, you know, he's so smart and he's got such good leadership skills. I was like, maybe he'll go run a company somewhere and be able to stay home and not have to worry about money. And so I asked him, I said, all right, well, why do you need to do music? Because he'd been writing songs and playing guitar for a little while. He was like, you know that feeling you get when you hear a song and it just like it moves you. And I was like, got the bug, dude. There's nothing I can do about this. What is it about music that is so impactful? And why do we give, you know, sometimes like half of a church service to it? Is it because it's the tradition? Like it's what we've just learned to do? It's what we've come accustomed to? Or is it a preference thing? Or is there something deeper than that? Tonight, I want to talk about why we worship. And the first reason is that it's natural. It is natural. It is in our nature to sing. One of the most common things that you see God's people doing throughout Scripture is singing and making music. When the children of Israel come out of their slavery in Egypt, they get through the Red Sea, the crazy Red Sea situation. They get to the other side. You know what the first thing is that Moses does? He writes a song. And then him and the entire people sing it together. When Mary gets the instructions from the angel or the information from the angel, hey, you're going to be carrying the Messiah of the world. That's the thing that she does. She sings. She writes a song. And she sings it. Why do they do this? Nobody taught them to do this. Nobody would, like, it wasn't like Moses got through the Red Sea and he started like chanting the words to this song, and people are like, whoa, dude, where's the melody? You can't do that. You gotta sing, bro. It was in him. It was already in him. Music was in him. Nobody told these people to do these things. The song was already in there. In the same way that God made us to talk so we could communicate, made us to walk so we could get places, God made us to sing so that we could worship. Which is why there is an entire book of the Bible of songs. The entire book of songs is 150 songs. My wife put together this road trip playlist. It is 7 hours of just like driving music, right? It only had like 120 songs on it. It was 7 hours of music. The book of Psalms is 150 songs, including instructions to the musicians at the top of the song, telling them to what chord progressions or music or melody they're supposed to play the songs. It's like God put a playlist of his favorite songs in the middle of his book. That's how much music matters to God. We were made to worship in song, which is why our passage says today, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your hearts to the Lord. But it's not just that God commands us to sing, but God himself sings. In Zephaniah chapter 3, God is telling Israel how he will restore them. And he says this, I'll give it on the screen. The Lord your God is in your midst. The mighty one will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Fun fact, this word, the word for rejoice here in the Hebrew actually means to twirl about with overwhelming joy. God describes himself as dancing and singing with overwhelming joy for his people. And then we see it in Jesus. What's one of the last things that Jesus did with his disciples? They're at the dinner together at the Last Supper, and they sing. And then Jesus is on the cross, and the second to last thing that Jesus says is, my God, why have you forsaken me? We know this. We've probably heard this before. What you may not know is that Jesus was quoting a 1,000-year-old worship song. And he was saying it loud enough, and the way that they would do this, and we do this too. If I go, what a beautiful name it is, you go, right? I sing the first lyric, you just join in. Jesus was doing what worship leaders had done for 1,000 years with Psalm 22. He was starting the song for the people. Because the rest of the song was a revelation of what the Messiah would do and how he would die. And so every single Jew within earshot would have tuned in like you guys just did right now. And when he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? All of them would have started quoting and probably singing the rest of it in their minds from memory. Jesus from the cross quotes a song lyric. As people created in the image of God, we have music woven into the fabric of our being. As common as eating or drinking or walking or talking, it may sound strange, but singing is one of the most natural things that we can do. But here's what's so cool. It's not just that we were made to sing, but stuff happens when we sing. Like every command in Scripture, it's not just that it glorifies God, but it is actually for our benefit. Singing actually changes us. It's not just natural. Musical worship is transformational. Why does God command and demonstrate and emphasize music? Why not talking? Why melodies and lyrics? Why not chanting or something like that? Well, 1,000 years ago, you would have never had to ask this question. Even 100 years ago, you wouldn't have had to ask this question. It was a part of the culture. People just sang. But now, for whatever reason, we have given singing to the professionals. We're like, oh, you do it. Even at sporting events, the people used to sing the national anthem. Now we're like, let's hire some famous person to come and sing. Let's pay them to sing. We'll all just listen and kind of like hum along. And so we have to ask ourselves, like, well, why is music important? We have to remind ourselves, why is music important? Well, one of the reasons is that it changes us. First of all, it changes us individually. If you focus your attention on something for long enough, you will begin to conform to it. This is why the Bible puts such an emphasis on Scripture and meditating on God's word. It's why we at churches put such an emphasis on preaching God's word. But here's what's crazy about singing specifically. When you sing, it activates the part of your brain that is associated with memory. It's the reason that you don't teach kids the ABCs like this. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J. Okay, now you do it. We go A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and they're like, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, right? It activates the part of your brain associated with memory. If you want to learn something, sing it. This is like why classical education does this, right? They sing like the math facts, right? One of the most effective ways for us then to replace false belief systems that we have in our minds and that we now use as like a lens to see our lives and the world of God through, the best way to replace that is to begin singing about it. Music changes us. And many of us have experienced this. You know, you're feeling a certain way, or you're stressed, or you're anxious about something, and you come into church and the music starts, and something changes in you. Something begins to shift in you. Anxiety begins to dissipate. Your perspective begins to change. Why? Well, this is how God made us. We are changed when we sing. But more specifically, we're changed when we sing together. And we are changed together when we sing together. Because it's not just that we're changed individually, we are changed corporately. When we sing, we are united with one another. And here's why that's so important. One of the last things that Jesus prayed for his disciples in John 17 was that we would be united. He said, Father, I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one. Jesus didn't pray that we would have boldness. He didn't pray that we would abound in our gifts, that we would have great wisdom. He prayed that we would have unity. In 2013, researchers in Sweden conducted this study in which they measured the heart rates of a group of choral singers in a choir who were singing together. And what they found was that the cadence of the music and the rhythms of the lyrics required each member to inhale and exhale at the exact same interval, so much so that as the members sang in unison, their pulses began to sync up, falling and rising at the exact same time. Another study was done by a team at the Keck Graduate Institute that measured the neurology of those who participate in group singing. They discovered that those who sang together experienced a significant rise in the hormone oxytocin. Oxytocin is released in the body when we experience love, when we experience a deep connection or a social bond with another. In other words, when we sing together, our hearts, both physically and relationally, intertwine with one another. This is why national anthems are supposed to be so powerful. They unite us around something that's greater than ourselves and remind us of a shared national identity. And for a brief moment, you feel strangely connected to hundreds or maybe thousands of people who you don't even know. But when we come together as kingdom people and sing anthems of praise to God, we are reminding ourselves of our spiritual identity, our spiritual heritage, and that we belong to someone greater than ourselves. This unites us. We are changed when we worship together. But you know what else changes when we worship? Our circumstances. Circumstances can actually change when we worship. In 2 Chronicles 20, King Jehoshaphat and the people of God are up against this impossible army made up of three different countries who are coming against them. They're like, dude, we're going to be destroyed. And so they pray, and God speaks to King Jehoshaphat through this prophet in the people of Israel. And he says, you will not need to fight in this battle. Stand still, and you will see the salvation of the Lord. And so Jehoshaphat falls on his face. He's worshiping God. And I don't know if it's the Holy Spirit, or if God speaks this to him, or if it's just an idea that he has, but he decides the next morning to put the worship team, the singers, and the players on instruments out on the front lines of the army as they start marching forward. Y'all know some musicians? This is a terrible military plan. But they go out and they start singing, praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever. Whatever song it was. Maybe it was a new song, maybe it was a song they've been singing all the time, who knows. But they're singing this song. And as they begin to sing, It says that God sends a confusion over the enemy. They get all confused. They start fighting against themselves, killing off one another. They're destroyed. Israel gets the victory. The people of God send, the enemy was destroyed. In Acts 16, we read it this morning, right? Paul and Silas are arrested for preaching the gospel. So there they are in prison, needing their circumstances to change. And what do they do? I'm going to read it again. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once, the prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. This morning, we talked about the power of prayer, but we got to notice here that they were not just praying. They were praying and singing hymns to God. So worshiping God is not just a response to his character and his presence, which it is. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. But it is also a weapon of spiritual warfare. I love how John Piper says it. He says, the Holy Spirit is our great hope against Satan. But how does the Holy Spirit fill and empower us? Be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your hearts to the Lord. One of the primary ways that the fullness of the Spirit is experienced in his people is a heart filled with singing. If we fight Satan with the fullness of the Spirit, we fight him with a song. So do you have some kind of stronghold in your life, some kind of prison door, again, that needs to be opened? There is power in prayer. We talked about that this morning, but we have to know that there is power in worship. Sometimes spiritual battles are won when we worship. As the great missionary Amy Carmichael once said, I believe truly that Satan cannot endure it and so slips out of the room more or less when there is a true song. So we prioritize musical worship then because it's natural. God made us to do it. It is transformational. Things change when we worship. And because musical worship is irreplaceable. It is irreplaceable. Why does God give us commands? Is it because he's strict? Why does he give us a bunch of rules? Is it because he's strict or it's arbitrary? He's just like, I don't know, I feel like putting some rules in place. No, God gives us rules for the same reason that hopefully parents give their kids rules. If there's, you know, some teenagers who are still in the house, hopefully if we're doing a good job as parents, the reason we're giving the rules is because we want to create an environment where you can flourish. The reason that God gives his commands is to create an environment where humanity can flourish. That means that if you follow all the commands of God, there will be flourishing in your life. And so when Jesus says, here's the two commands you got to think about. Love the Lord your God with everything you got, and love your neighbor as yourself. If you want flourishing in your life, follow what Jesus said. He says it like this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all of your strength. This is the greatest commandment. There are many ways that we can do this, okay? There's many ways we can love the Lord our God with heart, soul, mind, and strength. But I would like to make the argument that there is no other singular act on the planet that accomplishes this more holistically than musical worship. Because it engages all of these at the same time. First, it engages the intellect. It engages the intellect. For some of you, you're naturally more like cerebral people. And so you process information in your brain first, and then your feelings second, right? Your heart second. And so for you, maybe worship is already a primarily intellectual experience. For others, it may be a primarily felt experience. There's a lot of emotion in it. Maybe you're a feeler. You process things with your feelings first, and then your thinking second. Musical worship is meant to engage both. It should hit the mind and the heart. But the words should make us think. The words should make us think. And the music should make us feel. So then when it comes to lyrics, we need to be thoughtful about what we are singing. And for those of us who have the job of picking out songs and choosing which songs are in the catalog of things that we're singing at church or writing songs, we have to be thoughtful about the lyrics. They should be both biblically sound and intellectually meaningful. This is the beauty of hymns, right? This is why a lot of us love hymns so much, because most hymns were written by theologians. And theologians, most of them, were thinkers. And so when they wrote these songs, they wrote these songs with very dense theological, intellectual substance. The downside is that thinkers are often disconnected from how their theology connects to their humanity. Now we almost have the opposite problem. A lot of like creatives and artists are writing the worship songs. And a lot of creatives are feelers, not thinkers. And so they're very connected to their human experience. They're very connected into what's happening inside of them, but sometimes at the expense of good theology. But we should worship God with both. We should be thinking about both. We should be worshiping him with our minds. But not just with our minds. Because musical worship doesn't just hit the intellect. It also hits the emotions. It may sound weird to think about musical worship as being like an emotional thing. Because we often associate emotions with being like erratic and unstable and highs and lows. Like we don't compliment somebody who's emotional, right? You know, like, dude, I met this guy, he was super kind, he was handsome, he was emotional, he was like, who don't say that, right? We don't like value that as like a good characteristic. And so it's weird to talk about like it as maybe a positive thing. You may have even heard people say something like, well, worship isn't about emotions. Worship isn't about emotions. It's a valid question. Is it about emotions? Is there even a place in worship for emotions? Well, worship at its core is a response to God. The question is then, what is the right response? And does it involve emotions? Is it emotional? If I stood before the Grand Canyon and had no and felt nothing. No awe, no wonder, maybe a little fear. You'd be like, well, there's something wrong with Dom. And there would be something wrong with me. I think in the same way, if we stand before the God of the universe and feel nothing, then there's probably something wrong with us. Emotions are a good thing. Yes, they need to be shepherded. They need guardrails, but so do our thinking. So does our thinking. So do our thoughts. God is described in Scripture as one who has emotions. Jesus experienced the full gamut of emotions, and we don't see him trying to like run away from them. He's experiencing them, and we are created in his image. But dude, I just can't really engage with my emotions. I'm not really in touch with my feelings, okay? You know how you can get more in touch with your feelings? Music helps us do this. Is there any other created thing that can move a person's heart like music? This is why soundtracks are so powerful. I heard one film composer say recently that the dialogue and the picture in a film tell you what to think. The music tells you what to feel. Maybe this is one of the reasons why God put such an emphasis on songs and singing. When the truth is spoken, it's telling us what to think about God. But when it is accompanied by music and melodies, it's telling us what to feel about God. Martin Luther, the old reformer, who you wouldn't expect to say something like this, he has this whole section on musical worship, but this is one little sentence from him. He says, experience proves that next to the word of God, only music deserves to be extolled as the mistress and governess of the feelings. He goes on to say, only next to the word of God alone, I give music the highest place in my life. Musical worship cannot and should not be just an intellectual act. It is an emotional act. But it's not just intellectual and emotional. It is also physical. In the Bible, there are two words that are mostly used for worship. In the Old Testament, it's this word shachar. You got to do that like thing. And it means to prostrate oneself, to bow down on your face before a king or a deity. In the New Testament, it's the word proskuneo. Pros, it means turn toward. Kuneo, to kiss. Proskuneo, to turn toward and to kiss. Both of them are inspired by heart actions, but they are manifested in this physical action. Worship should begin in the heart, yes, but it shouldn't stay there. And I think that's what happens a lot of times with us. But
it would be like me looking at my wife. Let's say my wife gets all, she gets dressed up, she does her hair, we're gonna go out on a date, and she comes out, and I think to myself, and I have a feeling to myself, wow, she is great. But I don't say anything to her, and I don't show her any action that gives her a cue. I think she's beautiful. It's the same thing when we worship. Yes, it should start inside, but just like a lover has to let it out, and in fact, our praise is not complete until we let it out, which is why we have a desire. God made us to not just feel like, gosh, that thing is beautiful. What do you have to say? You're like, oh, it's beautiful, right? You see the Grand Canyon, you're like, oh my gosh, that was incredible. You have to say something about it, because praise is complete of anything or anyone. It's complete when we actually get it out. In the same way that a lover has to get it out, we don't just keep it inside. We get it out and we give God the praise. This is why Scripture tells us to offer our bodies, to lift our hands, to dance in worship to God, to bow down. This is why Scripture doesn't just tell us to think and feel lyrics. It tells us to sing lyrics. Did you know that singing engages 120 muscles in your body? 120 muscles have to be used to sing. People ask me all the time, hey, is it harder to preach or sing? The preparation to preach is way harder. But the physical act of singing and leading worship, it's exhausting. You're using so many muscles. By design, God made it like that. It's not a passive thing. It's not just something that happens to us or lives inside of us. It is something that we have to engage in physically. It's intellectual, it's emotional, it is physical. And I honestly don't know any other singular act on the planet that engages the heart, mind, soul, and strength like musical worship does. And here's what's so beautiful about this. It's not just that when we do this, we are obedient. Like, oh, this is the right thing to do, we should do this. Or God's glorified in it. That's true. But we flourish when we do this. Again, when we obey God's commands, it causes flourishing in us. Jesus summed up all of God's commands by saying, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. What is the greatest way that we can do that? I believe that it is starting here. That means that if you want to see flourishing in your life, I think there is no better place to start than with musical worship. So, what does that look like? Hopefully I just explained the why of worship, but how? What should it look like? Well, the first thing that we have to know is that true worship always comes from the heart. In John chapter 4, Jesus meets this woman at a well, and they begin having this conversation. And Jesus is about to reveal himself to her as the Messiah, but before he does that, she asks him this question about worship. I'll put it up on the screen. John 4, she's like, okay, Jesus, our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where you must worship is in Jerusalem. Woman, Jesus replied, believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. Yet a time is coming and now has come when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth. Jesus, should we worship outside or should we worship inside? Should we have a big band or should we have somebody on the organ? Should we sing hymns or should we sing contemporary songs? Jesus says, you're asking the wrong questions. It doesn't matter where you worship. It matters where your worship comes from. True worship comes from the heart. And how do we posture our hearts in worship? Four quick ways. The first way we posture our hearts is vertically. Yes, there is a horizontal component to worship. That's what our passage says. It says, sing to one another in songs and hymns and spiritual songs. Like that song, How Great Is Our God? It's like, how great is our God? Sing with me, right? It's like, sing with me. We're telling each other, come on, sing the Lord. There is a component that is horizontal, but the object of worship is always God. It is vertical. Worship is to God, about God, and for God. That means that the worship team is not here to entertain you. They don't pick songs to make you happy. That's what the DJ does. That's not what worship leaders are supposed to do. They are here to help you direct your heart to Jesus.
direct your eyes to Jesus, to bring your help you bring your worship to Jesus. It's not about a vibe. It's not about who we prefer singing or not singing, if we like that band set up or don't. It's not about a genre. If it's about a genre, dude, I'd just be playing Warrior every time I got on stage, because like that's my vibe. That's what I like. It's not about a vibe, though. I play these like white guy worship songs. I don't write songs like that, but it's not about me. It's about whatever the best song is to help people get to a place of worship. It's not about any of that stuff. It is about Jesus. And because worship is to God, about God, and for God, that also means that it doesn't really matter if we feel it or not. If we're like, I feel like worshiping today. You know, I just wasn't really feeling it, so I didn't engage. God's worthiness is what dictates our worship. Our worship isn't about how we feel. It is about the worthiness of God.
Amen.
Because worship is not a response to our feelings. It's a response to His character and His presence, which brings us to our next point. We posture our hearts vertically, yes, but it's not a cold-hearted posture. It is a relational posture. We posture our hearts relationally. I love Psalm 33. It says, praise the Lord with the harp and make music to Him. Why? For the word of the Lord is right and true. He is faithful in all He does. The Lord loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of His unfailing love. Praise God in song, the psalmist says. But why? Because of who He is and what He has done. Worship is a response to God's character. And it is also a response to His presence. Look at Psalm 95. It says, come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. The implication is not just like, wow, God's character is awesome and He's over there, but God's character is awesome and He's right here. Bow before Him. He's not over there, He's right here. And so we are not just singing about God, we are singing to God, before God, with Him in our presence and us in His presence. And it has to be both. It has to be a response to God's character, but it also has to be a response to His presence. Because here's why. Because you can respond to somebody's character without ever engaging relationally with them. You can, you know, somebody does something nice for you at work or whatever, and you say, hey, I'd like to say thank you to you for this kind thing that you have done for me. And never engage your heart relationally. But when somebody's presence is with you, for instance, if my wife comes and sits next to me, her presence demands a response from me. I can either choose closeness and lean in, or I can choose distance and kind of like push away. It's the same thing with God. When we come into His presence demands a relational response. We either want closeness, we lean in, or we want distance, we push away. Both of them have profound relational implications. Psalm 95, verses 6 and 7 says, come, let us worship and bow down. I'm just going to keep reading. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is God. Then look at this relational language. We are the people of His pasture, the flock under His care. So it's the same thing. We come into God's presence. We can either choose to lean in and choose closeness, or we can choose to push away and choose distance. But to lean in is to choose to worship. To worship is to choose closeness. And God wants us close. In the beginning, Adam and Eve walked with God in the cool of the day. There was this intimate relationship, and then sin came in and it separated and broke that intimacy. But through Jesus on the cross, all of that is reconciled. Remember, the veil was torn in two. There was this separation, like literally a physical separation. Only the priest could go in one time a year, and even then he went into the presence of God with trepidation. Do you know they used to tie a rope around the priest's waist in case he just died in the presence of God? Nobody else would have to go in, and they could just pull him back out. It was terrifying. And then that veil was torn, and God was like, no longer is there any fear. No longer is it just one dude one time a year. Come on in. We read it this morning. Come boldly into my presence. God wants us close. He wants us in. He wants us right in His presence. How close? Well, in John 4, Jesus uses that word when He's speaking to the woman at the well. He uses that word for worship, proskuneo, to turn toward and to kiss. part of what Jesus purchased on the cross was access to intimacy. God doesn't want routine, cold, disconnected sing-alongs, because what happens is things become transactional. When we only respond to God's character, and some of us probably grew up like this in churches, where it's like God is, he's sovereign, he's almighty, he's powerful, and so worship and singing and our response to him, it is, it's probably mostly cerebral, and it's transactional. It's like, you have done this for me, and now God, I would like to say thank you to you. And there is not a lot of engagement in the heart. But when you're not engaging the heart, you're not engaging relationally. And everything that God does is relational. He died so that we could be with him. Jesus died so that we could be with the Father. Not like over here, and we're like in the family, but we like don't get to live in the same house as him. He's like, no, 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 come to my table. It's always come to my table. There is no more separation. He wants us to engage relationally. So we posture our hearts relationally, but we also do it honestly. One of the things that Jesus says to this woman at the well in John 4 is, God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship him in spirit and in truth. To worship God in truth means that, yes, we worship him according to the whole counsel of his will, whatever form it takes, it has to line up with scripture. But to worship God in truth also means that we worship him honestly. That is not an outward display of spirituality. But with integrity. Like what's happening inside is the same thing that's happening outside, which is what Jesus was constantly rebuking the Pharisees for, right? And he would call them hypocrites. It's literally means actor. They were acting. They were putting on a show. They were putting on an outward display of worship, but their hearts were far from God. And in some ways, I think we have created a bit of a culture like that in the church where we don't value vulnerability and honesty of the heart, and so it makes us kind of fake it before God. But God wants our honesty. He wants our messy, unresolved hearts. He wants our messy situations, as crazy as they may be. He wants it, because here's the deal: to not allow God into the messed up parts of our hearts is to not allow him into the whole of our hearts. Because here's what we end up doing. We're like, I don't know, God, I'm guarding this part. It's something scary. It's something I don't even like to look at, or it's something I'm ashamed of, or whatever. So we guard it, and what we don't realize is that as we're guarding it, we're also preventing the inflow of whatever God has for us. Yeah. You put your hand over the vessel because you don't want like the stuff to come out, but you're also preventing stuff from coming in. To worship God in truth means that we worship him in honesty, which means in vulnerability and openness, which coincidentally is the same posture required to receive and to let things flow in. So we posture our hearts vertically, relationally, honestly, and lastly, we posture our hearts exclusively. What's interesting about this idea of proskuneo, I love like just getting deep into like the imagery of some of these things. Turn toward and kiss. Have you ever been kissing someone and then you're trying to look at something else? Like, you can't do it, right? Like, I literally can't see anything except for my wife's face right in front of me. What's so cool about proskuneo is you literally can't turn your eyes anywhere else. This is the kind of worship that God is after. Jesus says in Luke 9, anyone who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. He's talking about a divided heart. He's talking about trying to hold on to the things of the world and hold on to Jesus at the same time. You can't do it. The kind of worship that Jesus speaks of in John 4 is the kind that comes from a single-minded, single-hearted devotion. It's the first command in the Ten Commandments: you shall have no other gods before me. Just you, Lord. It's just you. Part of what should happen in worship then is that we are examining our hearts to see if there is any other gods that we have put before him. Has anything stepped up onto the throne of our hearts and taken the place of Jesus? And if it has, then we need to deepen on those things and allow Jesus to be back on the throne. And so we let go of whatever has that we're trying to hold on to. I love this imagery in John. John 4, it says that this woman who came with this water jug, it said, I love this detail, it says, and leaving her water jug, she goes back and tells everybody about the Messiah that she's just met. It's like she, everything her life, everything that was represented by her life was represented in that water jug. Everything she was holding on to, all of her identity, all of her past sin, everything, it's right there. She's like, dude, this doesn't even matter anymore. Only Jesus matters. And it's not lost on me that the same action of letting go of something is the same action required to receive something. It's, you got to open up. You got to open up your hands. It's a beautiful picture. And so we must let go of the water jugs in our lives if we are going to grab hold of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for your word, the power of your word, and thank you for the gift of worship. And so as the worship team even comes up right now, we ask God that you would just help us to turn our hearts towards you. Help us to turn our minds towards you. We want to be a people who don't just tolerate singing worship songs, who don't look at worship as like the, oh yeah, that's the thing, that's like a buffer on the back or the front of the sermon. But the sermon's really the thing, because that's the word of God. Lord, you command us to value musical worship, and so we want to do that. That's your heart. And so we want to do that. We want to be a people who do that. I pray that you would grow that. I know there's already a culture of that in this church, but I pray that you would enhance that and you would grow this a culture of loving worship and responding in worship and there being freedom and relational engagement in worship. I pray that you would continue to grow that culture in this church. In Jesus' name. Amen. So here's what we're going to do right now, guys. We're going to transition into a response time. Historically, in the last couple years, there's been this idea that musical worship prepares us for the Word of God, which is why we orchestrated our services the way they do for so long. But what we see in Scripture is that the Word of God actually prepares us to worship. It's not just that worship prepares us to receive, but the Word of God prepares us to respond in worship. And so one of the things that we started doing in our church a long time ago, and we just do it every single Sunday, is we actually put all the music on the back end. We do like 15 minutes up front, and we do like almost 30 minutes on the back. And it ends up being the climax of the service, not because like I'm a musician or something, but because what we see in Scripture is that there needs to be a response, because God speaks to us through His Word. Right? God speaks to us through His Word. He moves in our hearts. And then what we often do is we just go out, we leave, we go get some breakfast or something, or grab a cookie, and we just forget about what God had done in us. But this is a time where we can respond to Him. Where we can respond to Him. And we can do it in song. And so I would encourage you to do that. When we gather on Sundays, when we gather right now, guys, we're gathering around Jesus, and I want you to just imagine, like, what if whoever you honor the most in life or history, just imagine that you got to go to their house. You got to go to their table. They invited you to sit down at their table. And they invited you. They wanted to engage with you relationally. They wanted to talk to you. They wanted to hear from you. And you wanted to hear from them. And then they were like, hey, everything that's in my house, everything that I own, it's also yours. And you're like, what would I even do? And you're like, you did nothing. You did nothing. But it's all yours. This is what God has done for us in Christ. He's like, come to my table. Come to my table. All that I have is yours. How would you respond if somebody did that? How would you honor them? Let us honor Jesus like that now. Let us bow before Him. What would be the physical response you would take? What would be the physical posture you would take if you were in that kind of royalty's presence? With that kind of grace and mercy and love towards you, how would you respond? What would your physical response be? What would happen in your heart? What would be going on in your mind? This is how we get to respond to Jesus, and what a gift music is. For us to be able to do this, I know no other way that we can just pour out the adoration, our adoration on Jesus, other than musical worship. So right now, I want to encourage you to just put into practice these things. Like, let this be about Him. Let it be vertical. Engage with Him relationally. Let it be cerebral thing or maybe only an emotional thing. Let it be both. Like, gosh, think about the lyrics, but allow the music to move your heart. And let it be physical. Maybe you have a, maybe some of you guys are like, you're physical people, and so it's common for you to maybe get on your knees or raise your hands or sing at, you know, your full voice. But maybe for some of us, we're a little bit more timid, or maybe the culture we grew up in was just like, it's not something we do. Like, my buddy grew up in a Presbyterian church. He's like, we called ourselves the Frozen Chosen, you know? Like, maybe that's the culture you grew up in. That's all right, dude. There's no like judgment here. But the Bible does command us to worship him with our bodies. And here's what's so cool about taking postures of praise, whether it's kneeling or sometimes I honestly just love to get on my face, or lifting your hands or singing. Here's what's so powerful about this sometimes. Sometimes our hearts just aren't there. We're like, gosh, I'm really struggling, Lord. I'm doubting you. I don't have a lot of faith right now. I'm discouraged. I'm tired. I feel beat up, whatever. It's like, I don't really want to worship you. And you can't control that. You can't control your heart. You can't just like change your heart. You know you can't control your body. And sometimes when we take physical postures of worship, I don't know why or how, but our hearts start to follow. And so sometimes I'll just lift my hands because I know that I need to surrender cerebrally, but I'm not feeling like I want to surrender. And I'll just put my hands in a posture of surrender. And it's like, whoa, something happens inside of me when I do that. Something happens inside of me. So I would encourage you to take a physical posture, whatever that looks like. The room is open. It's even really dark in here, so like you don't have to worry about people looking at you. Just take a posture that's responding. We're going to sing a bunch. We're going to sing for about 20 or 30 minutes right now. So let's just do it. Talk to your Father. Be honest with him. Pour out adoration and praise. This moment.
Allow you to work in all these ways.
Whoa.